to our shit. Podcast. I wanted to talk to this one. Not at first. Just got a ride. You gotta be 35 and up to even understand who this is. I know all my youngsters, they don't know. They don't even know who this is. It's a classic right here. Songs ever made. Frankie Beverly and May's classic. One of my favorite greatest hits too. One of my favorite CDs or whatnot. It's Friday too. But I'm gonna soften you up for that part. It's part of the podcast, mobile mentorship. Always on the road. So I figured I might as well add some value while driving. But I want to talk about a few things. Serious subjects. So I want to make sure that content I'm covering today, not disrespect anyone who's involved. Serious topic. And I want to talk about dealing with mental health. But I want to spend a few minutes talking about what happened last year with Junior Seau, Jovan Belcher, and O.J. Murdoch. And I believe there was one more person. I believe it was. But I definitely wanted to hit those notes because, you know, that impacted me. You know, one, as it should, I'm a human being. I would hope that no one would want to see anyone take their life for whatever reason, you know. So that's first, as a human being. And then as a mental health professional, you know, I never want to see that. So personal and professional, you know, there's an athletic component too. Those of you who have played sports, you know, that right there is one thing that we all have in common. We all play sports. There's a certain bond, whether you know someone or not. If you ever notice, you know, athletes tend to get along with athletes for the most part, you know, there are exceptions or whatnot. But the biggest thing, and I know that we'll never truly know why. I think we can only gather information and try our best to make assessments, you know, if you look at their whole life, not just their athletic life. You know, we have to look at their life as a whole to see, you know, what was the issue or issues or, you know, what happened. Which as a practitioner, I'm always interested in what happened. I'm always interested in how mental health impacts student athletes and athletes period, people period, but we'll just talk about my specialty. And here's the one thing among many that I believe happened, and I wish I could have been involved somehow, you know, before. I believe differently. You know, I believe that those are people that I needed to talk to. And that's just me being who I am as a person, a professional, I believe that with no hesitation. But I know one, obviously, there was something that they couldn't cope with, you know, while living. And that's a tough subject in itself, just being able to cope. So I think that's the part I guess you could say that's obvious, you know. And I've read and I've done, you know, done research and engaged in conversations and dialogue with people about it. You know, some who are mental health professionals, some who are not. So you get different viewpoints, but I look at Junior Seau in particular because I followed Junior Seau his entire career, and I believe it's only a part of it. This is a part of my theory, not the entire theory, but I believe that as passionate as he was on the field, and he was a passionate player. I mean, he had high energy. And those of you that actually watch football, you know who's high energy. You know who makes plays and walks back to the huddle. You know who really gets excited. You know, you need those type of players on your team. You need some players that could provide a spark for your team. There's many types of different players on each team. You know, I think that's the beautiful part about playing sports. You have so many different personalities, you know, on one team. You know, it's like life. Microcosm life. So Junior Seau was high motivated, high motor, relentless effort. You could tell he played, he was very passionate, man. It's like he almost wore his emotion on his sleeve, you know, while he played. And he was a savage. I don't mean that, but I know, you know, using that as derogatory. That's just not one of the things that I say. Like, he was a savage. He was a beast, you know, for his entire career. He was a beast in college. You know, I'm in that generation, younger than him, obviously, but I'm in that generation to where I watched him. And anyone who played linebacker had to watch Junior Seau. I don't care what they say. They had to watch Junior Seau, had to watch 55. But in making the connection between mental health, football, life purpose, I do believe that some people, their life purpose is to play football. But I also believe that they have more than one life purpose then, because you can't play football forever. You can coach, you can, you know, player development, you can, there's a number of areas that you can go into, you know, football related. But I don't believe that it was his life purpose, because you can't do that forever. True life purpose, something true inside. But I believe that there is a relationship, that there's a connection between his passion on the field, and it doesn't appear to me that he had an outlet off of the field where he could expend that energy in the same fashion. Have to think about that for, you know, for a few seconds. You know, he had so much passion on the field, I could see why there was a void, you know, once he could no longer perform, or once he decided to leave the game, leave the NFL. That's a big void, in addition to all the other factors, you know. Once you are out of the NFL, you're out. You know, that's a special club. That's a special group. You know, you have to have some sort of affiliation for access. You know, access granted, but I think that was big. So the first thing that I wonder when I think about Junior Seau in the context of that part of the conversation, this part of the message, is what if he had something like a program or a mission in life, an activity where he could utilize that energy. I'm not saying he had to run around and run 15 million miles and run into walls and get that sort of, you know, that feeling. But what I'm saying is that I can compare it to my own life to where, can you do something? This is the question for the student athletes watching, even the professional athletes. Can you do something off of the field that gives you the same satisfaction, the same, you know, emotional fulfillment, so to speak? Can you do something that matches making a great play on the field? And I believe that is what was missing for him. Because had he found it, I think he would still be here today. I truly believe that. And most guys don't find that. Most guys don't find that. So that tells me that we need to, we as a whole need to do more training on that. We need to help guys tap into their life purpose and their life task, and trying that true vocation. Because that vocation is what saves lives. You know, vocation is, you know, by definition is that authentic self. You know, something that you can do the rest of your life. That's tied into your authentic self. Something like childlike, you know, when you're real young. There's something inside all of us that we are meant to do. There's an activity that we're meant to do. There's an indefinite activity. And I can say that I get as much enjoyment, you know, helping student athletes, professional athletes solve problems, helping people solve problems, helping student athletes navigate, counseling youth who are struggling, families are struggling. I get just as much enjoyment doing that as I did when I made a great play on the field, whether that's baseball or football, you know, throughout my childhood. And I think that, you know, I'm blessed that I found that. You know, I had to work for it. It took me years to figure that out, but I had to work for it. But I think that's the biggest message. I'm gonna talk about OJ and Javon later. But I want to talk about Junior Seau, because I believe that's something that needs to be talked about from the community in general. So that's Scrimmage Line, mentoring consulting for you.